Hi, welcome to Unlock Layout and Design, and today we are going to discuss an important topic known as the high speed SERDES. Okay, let's now look into the contents. So first we will discuss about parallel and serial communication, then we will compare what are the pros and cons about this parallel and serial communication. Then when we do a high speed parallel transmission, there are some issues. We will discuss about that. Then we will introduce what is known as the SERDES. Then we will also look into what are the different serial communication protocols, and we will see how the channel behaves and what is the need for equalizer, different types of equalizers, and the top level diagram of SERDES. And in these are all covered in part 1. In part 2, we will look into all the circuits of SERDES. So parallel versus serial communication. In parallel transmitter and receiver, the data here we have like 8 bit data D0 to D7. So that will be like 8 bit data. This 8 bit data, it can be any number of bits. Okay, it can be 8 to 16, whatever, or even 4 bit, whatever number of data bits. Okay, so these data is like transferred from transmitter to receiver parallelly. So then in a serial communication, what happens is the data is transferred serially, means like first D0 is transmitted, then D1, D2, D3, like that. Okay. So, but then we cannot do that as it is. We need something known as the parallel to serial converter or encoder. And then here we need something known as the serial to parallel converter. Okay. So parallel data now should come as serial. So this kind of a mux. This is a mux multiplexer, and this is a demux or demultiplexer. Okay, so this one is converting parallel data to serial, that's why it is called a serializer. And this one is converting serial data into parallel data, that's why it is called as deserializer. That's how the name comes, SERDES. Okay, serializer, deserializer. Hope this is clear. Okay, so let's try and understand what are the differences between parallel and serial communication. So in parallel communication, just now we saw that the data is transmitted in parallel. In serial, data is transmitted serially. So in parallel communication, it's very obvious that more data is transmitted in very little time, and here less data is transmitted in the same time. Okay. And the next comparison point is the width of the cable is wide. Actually, it is very large. Okay, so this comes at a cost. It is cost of area, right? So we need wider area, routing congestion, everything would be there. Okay, but here in serial communication, I need very little area. The cable will be like lesser width, and that's how I will save area. So if I take a IC, if that is transmitting lot of data, so if I have a IC like this, I need like D0 to D7, so many pins, data pins only. Okay. Whereas if I have a serial communication, I need only one pin or maximum two pins. If it is differential, it is two pins. If it is with respect to ground like this, it is one pin. Or if it is differential, I need two pins. That's all. Okay. So now I will reduce the pin count by that means. And there is a problem that once we go like higher in speed, that is like more than 500 Mbps, it becomes very difficult to transmit a lot of parallel data. Okay. But now on the flip side of it, we can transmit serial data at much, much higher speeds. Currently, it is going around 112 Gbps. So that's a lot of speed. So let's try to understand what happens when these parallel lines are there, and when I do a high speed communication between these parallel lines. Okay. So this is D0, D1. So like that, like we have D7, suppose 8 bit data I have, I am doing like high speed parallel communication. So whenever I have a line like this, this is nothing but a wire, this is also one wire, this is also one wire. In between that we will have what is known as capacitance. It's like two conductors separated by an insulation, so I'll have some capacitance. And what is capacitive reactance, or the resistance of capacitance, is a function of frequency. Xc is 1 by 2 pi fc. Okay, so c is constant but frequency is like changing. Okay, once the frequency increases, what happens, this will act like a xc will reduce and it will act like a short circuit. Xc will act like a short circuit and now data should have gone like this, instead it will go like this. So it will create, it will interfere with the data of D0 and also D2. There is capacitance here also. Instead of data going straight in this D1, it will go and disturb the data in D0 and also D2. Okay. So similar thing happens with all lines, and then the data will get corrupted. So that's the problem with high frequency. If it is low frequency, then there is no issue. This capacitive impedance is like higher. If frequency is low, then XC is higher. So then it will be like distinct. These lines will be distinct, and whatever signal goes here, it will go and reach the destination without any attenuation. So now what is the solution? So I will move these lines away. Okay, so suppose say this is D0, this is D1. So I increase the distance between the two lines, hence I will reduce the capacitance. Now capacitance is smaller between these two. So now XC will be lesser. Okay, so this is one way of doing parallel communication, high speed parallel communication, by putting the lines away. But there is a disadvantage. What is the disadvantage? Now you would have all seen the USB connector. Okay, this one is the normal USB connector. It has only 4 pins. Okay, so it has got VDD, ground, and data, D plus and D minus. Okay, this is a differential signal, that's why you have only. So for 4 pins only, this one is so wide. Okay, the width is so much. Suppose I keep many lines like this, then what will happen to the width of this one? It will be so big. Okay, or even much higher. So suppose say in my PC I have to accommodate 4 or 5 of such ports, then where will be the space for that? Okay, so that becomes a problem. So it becomes costly in area. Okay, so if I have to faithfully transmit, then I have to increase the distance, and if I increase the distance, then it becomes like costly in area. But not only area, there are other issues. So between the lines, suppose say I have D0, D1, D2 different lines. Okay, so this is D0, this is D1, this is D2. There is something known as Q. Okay, so now suppose say this data was coming like this. Okay, this is the rising edge, then output 2 will come at a lagging, means like it will come after some time, so then the skew is lagging. Or output 3 can come arrive quickly, so that time there is a leading skew. So these things will affect the reliable data capture at the receiver. So transmitter, I sent everything at the same edge, but at the receiver I receive the data at a different timing skews. So that becomes a problem in order to synchronize this data, whatever is being transmitted. Okay, so this is a problem. And also there is something known as the propagation delay between the transmitter and receiver, that also creates a issue. And there is something known as EMI. Okay, EMI is electromagnetic interference. Suppose say I am transmitting the data on a line like this. So this is the digital data which is going on, say this is D0. Okay, there can be some electromagnetic interference. So the high frequency, high power signal which can come and disturb this signal. Instead of this signal being like this, it can distort it somewhat like this. So now how do I prevent that one? So I have to prevent my data from EMI. So what I do is, suppose say this is my wire, I'll put a shield across it. Okay, so So this is my data line and this is my shield. Okay, I can shield from EMI. So the EMI is filtered out by this shield from external. So it will come in air. Okay, so that is shielded by this EMI shield. Then my data will get transmitted properly. Okay, but now if I have parallel, how many shields will I put? It becomes difficult. So again, that will increase in area and shielding will become a problem. So keeping all these things in mind, we understand that parallel communication at high speeds, it is very difficult. So now we understand that parallel communication is difficult at high speed. So instead of doing, like suppose say this is 1 megahertz, I am transmitting data at 1 megahertz in parallel. What I do is I will use a speed of 8 megahertz and then I will transmit like D0, D1, D2, D3, like that D7 at 8x speed, so that all 8 bits will come at the same speed. So they will arrive here at the same time, but I have to increase the speed of my serial link. I will use only one data line, but I will increase the speed. That's how I do the communication serially, but I will increase the speed. So this transmitting serially at higher speed outpaces the parallel communication at lower speed. Okay, so that's how so it becomes more reliable to transmit data at higher speed but serially, rather than parallelly but at lower speed. So this gains the advantage, it becomes much easier. So if you see today, all of them have migrated from parallel to serial. Okay, so there are a lot of serial communication protocols such as CAN, which is used in automotive, controller area network. Then this is like your internet connection, Ethernet LAN. Then I have some small devices, I2C and SPI, which will connect a lot of peripherals, low speed peripherals. RS-232, you will see RS-232 port in your PC. And we all know USB. SATA is for hard disk. MIPI is for mobile parts, which will like the camera and the display unit. They will all communicate using serial communication only. That is called as MIPI standard. So also we have memory, which uses very high speed communication. That is also serial. And you can see like USB, HDMI, FireWire, and then you have like SATA, and you have Ethernet and PCI. All the computer peripherals, right? They interact with the CPU using PCI. Okay, peripheral component interface, I think. So that is PCI standard. So all of them use serial communication only. So the underlying principle is parallel to serial and serial to parallel. That is, like, all of them use a SerDes. If all of them use a SerDes, then why do we need so many protocols? So different protocols are there. So let's try to understand like how these protocols are there. Okay, so we know in protocols there are many layers. Okay, so first layer at the bottommost part is the actual transmitter receiver. Okay, transmitter receiver and the cable. Okay, so this is the USB protocol. So here you will do the parallel to serial conversion, all those things. On top of that, we need the digital data. How do that data come and all that will be like a controller. So this will be a digital controller. So this will generally be realized by a ASIC or a FPGA. Okay, so then on top of that, we'll have something known as this is called as kernel space. So this will be generally an operating system. Okay, so they will have device drivers and all others. And on top of that, I will build an application. So this can be in C, C++, C++, or it can be LabVIEW, etc. Other applications. So this is application area. So now, so what do we discuss as like VLSI engineers will be only these layers at the bottom, which is the hardware layers. Okay, so these layers are done by VLSI engineers. These are all done by software engineers for the same protocol. So every protocol will have these layers are different. Okay, and VLSI engineers will be working on the physical layer. See, you can see here, that's why it is called as PHY. PHY means physical layer. So they will be speaking about SerDes PHY for LPDDR, SerDes PHY for USB, SerDes PHY for HDMI, etc. PHY means physical layer. So this generally will be analog portion, and this generally will be the digital portion generally. Okay, so we understood what you mean by physical layer. So we will be working, VLSI engineers will be working in this layer, which is the hardware layer or the physical layer. So this is true for all protocols. Every protocol will have all these layers, and that will be different. The speeds will be different, everything will be different. Now let's try to understand the SerDes PHY physical layer block diagram. Okay, so we have digital data coming in here. Okay, so we know that we need a serializer. Then this is the channel or the wire. Okay, this is the wire. It can be a cable like a USB cable or HDMI cable or anything, or on a PCB it can just be a trace for, like, if it is on a CPU and a peripheral component interface like PCI. So in that case, it can just be a track on the PCB. Okay, and this is the deserializer. Okay, so this is the SerDes. Okay, so we have serializer and deserializer. We understand deserializer. We understand, and this is the channel. These three things we understand. But now we have what is known as the transmitter and receiver. Okay, which will enhance the signal. Before transmitting, I have to increase the power of the signal, and at the time of receiving, I have to increase the signal quality, because the channel will attenuate the signal. So channel will attenuate the signal. So for that, what we have to do is we have to increase the signal strength before transmitting, and after receiving also we have to boost the signal before we do the deserialization. Okay, after serialization we have to boost it, and before deserializing we have to boost it. So these are called as equalizers. So this is called as equalizers. We will discuss about that in a minute. Okay, let's try to understand what is the channel behavior. So channel means what? Some cable or wire or track, I explained earlier also. So it will be some copper material like this, and this copper material will have some resistance, correct? It will have some resistance, and it will also have some capacitance, because it will be with respect to ground, there will be some amount of capacitance. So this is C and this is R. This is my input and this is my output. Okay, so this capacitor, so this is nothing but a RC filter. Okay, so this is the RC equivalent circuit, RC filter. So XC, or this capacitive reactance, is like the resistance of the capacitor is a function of frequency. The resistance of a resistor is not a function of frequency. Okay, so but frequency dependent impedance, that's what we call it as impedance, is given by 1 by 2 pi fc. As frequency increases, what happens to xc? Xc decreases, and very high frequency, this will become like zero. That means to say, it will be like shorted to ground. That's what you see. Then that time there will be no signal will go from here to the output. Everything will go to ground. So that's what is this point. But at some frequency, it starts, the signal will start going to ground. A little bit of amount of signal will start going to ground, and majority will be going to output. And as the frequency increases, majority of it will go to ground and nothing will go to output. So that is your low pass behavior. So we understand that the channel has got a low pass behavior like this. At a higher frequency, the gain will fall. Okay, we understood that one, because of this capacitance. So now what should we do? We have to compensate for the loss at this higher frequency. Means if I have a technique to increase the gain at this higher frequency, then I can compensate for this loss at higher frequency. frequency. So that is exactly the job of equalizer. So equalizer will have a frequency dependent gain. Okay, so now here this is like the signal and it will get attenuated at higher frequency, but I will put a equalizer which will have a gain curve like this. So overall my bandwidth now it will be flat like this till this frequency. That's what you see here in this diagram. So earlier it would have been something like this. Now because of the equalizer it increased like this. So now it started being flat. So gain is there at higher frequency as well. So that is the role of equalizer. This is important. We must understand what is equalizer. So equalizer basically at low frequency it has not got gain, but higher frequency it has got gain. So that will compensate for the attenuation caused by the channel. Okay, so if I want to transmit signal, digital signal at say 5 gigahertz, okay, so now this channel has got bandwidth of say 1 gigahertz, this is 1 gigahertz and this is 10 gigahertz. So when I transmit somewhere in between like 5 gigahertz, there is attenuation. Okay, so what I do is I have a equalizer which will provide gain between 1 gigahertz and 10 gigahertz, so that my gain now till 10 gigahertz it is constant. So when I want to transmit data at 5 gigahertz it is very easy, I can transmit without any attenuation. So in equalizers we have got something known as the continuous time equalizer and a discrete time equalizer. What do you mean by continuous time equalizer? So for every the signal is something continuous like this, so we'll have the value for every signal over time. Okay, signal is continuous. What do you mean by discrete time? So I will take samples of the signal and I will reconstruct it this way. So this is called discrete time or sampled data system. Okay, so both the equalizers are used in a SERDES system. So in the transmitter I told you we have to boost the signal, so there I have a discrete time equalizer which is a FIR equalization. Okay, so FIR equalizer. At the receiver I have two types of equalizers. One is the CTLE means continuous time linear equalizer, so which is a continuous time equalizer. And we have one more type of equalizer which is known as the DFE, which is nothing but decision feedback equalizer. Decision feedback equalizer. CTLE is continuous time linear equalizer. Okay, so these are the three types of equalizers used. So here this FIRTX FIR equalization is a discrete time equalizer. CTLE, which is this one, it is a continuous time equalizer. And DFE, decision feedback equalizer, is again a discrete time. So now the entire SERDES top will look something like this. So we know the digital data will come here. We need a serializer, which is kind of a mux. Then we know that we need a equalizer to increase the strength of the signal before transmitting. This is the channel, and then we also know that once the signal comes here it will be weak. Okay, I'll send a good signal here, because of this one it will become like weak, so I have to boost it. I'll use like CTLE, continuous time linear equalizer, and a decision feedback equalizer, and I will bring back the signal to the same strength, and then I will use a deserializer to get back my signal, transmitted signal. Okay, now we need to do all these things, we need one clock as the reference as well, right? When we transmit and receive the data, we need clock, and that clock is generated by phase lock loop, which is nothing but PLL. And at the receiver side, what we do is we will recover not only the data which is sent here, something like this, we'll also recover the clock from this data only. We know from this data at what frequency it is coming. We will recover the clock also from that. That is known as the clock and data recovery. Clock data recovery, which is nothing but CDR, which is also kind of a PLL. Okay. So this becomes the top level of the SERDES. So in a SERDES, you can expect all these blocks, and we will discuss the circuits of each block in the next video. Thank you. So thanks for watching the video, and if you have liked this video about SERDES introduction, please hit the like button and don't forget to share and subscribe.